Thank you for the opportunity to come and speak with you guys. I guess and we are going to speak about animals, but this is really animal and molecular biology put together. And just to give you a rough idea where I come from sunny England, and we are in an animal house where we are producing about 150 new models every year, which means that we have lots of opportunity to see how the system behaves and how sometimes it can go wrong. So one thing to frame what I'm going to talk about, I'm not here to defend or not defend animal research. And we are going to take as a given that animal research is something that we want to do, and that it is something that is going to be useful for human health. And that's our framework. But where I would like to go towards in this context is what does change now with genome editing being around? And in particular, also, how does it change the way we are using animals and the sort of consideration that we have to apply when we are considering the ethical merit of making an animal experiment? So my first point here is that genome editing is a disruptive technology, and there are many ways by which we could illustrate that, but for me, there are three aspects which are fundamental. The first one is that somehow we are starting to create models which have a very specific and very intimate relationship between a particular animal model and some actual patients or families of patients. And what we and there is really a new dynamic happening between the research model and the person for which the research is being conducted. And in some way, that could work in two different ways. One could imagine that there is a lot of impetus and a lot of push towards creating lots of animal models because there are lots of people out there who have a need for cures. But in some ways also, those avatars are a representation of an experience that is also experienced in human beings. And those human beings who suffer from disease, they may or may not think it's a good idea to make an animal go through the same experience, especially if they are not convinced that the research is going to be what is going to give them a solution for their disease. So there is a really different and new relationship between animal models and the subject and the subject of and the people who are affected by disease. The other thing that I think is quite disruptive is we are really changing the level of sophistication of the animal that we are working with. They are much more complicated. I was nearly tempted to put a Maserati here instead of a beautiful exquisite mouse. But what you can see here, and I'm going to give you a couple examples, is that we are trying to make something which is more and more difficult and complicated very quickly, very efficiently, and that is not going to be without consequences. And finally, I think this is something that really I had not anticipated when I first started to work with genome editing, which is that in some ways, of course, we are working with mice and it is all about laboratory research and stuff like that. But while we are doing things like that, which is very focused in academia, what we are doing is creating the mean to change the human genome. And that is happening without it being necessarily our primary intention. But this is a direct consequence of what we are doing in animal models. And this is something we need to keep in mind. This is not an isolated environment. It leads to a different world, and obviously it leads to the ability to change human genome. So let's assume that it's all okay, that we are satisfied that what we are doing is an ethically allowable endeavor, and we are going to change animal model. But of course, the next thing that is going to need to happen is we are going to apply ourselves some rules as to how we are going to go about this. And really, these three rules are summarized by this little acronym, the three R's. And these are the fact that we have to always try, of course, while working with animal model, to act with particular intent. So the first intent is that we all should always aim to reduce the number of animals that we are going to be working with. But of course, when we are working with mice and genome editing, the thing that we are doing is somehow pushing further and further our ability to make more exciting, more interesting, more complex alleles. So we started introducing a bit of randomness, and now we are able to make really nicely tailored deletion and just decide which point mutation we are going to put. And nowadays, we are pushing the envelope in terms of how broad, how large new sequence we are going to introduce with exquisite specificity into the genome. Doing that, we are indeed reducing the number of animals that we are using because we are becoming more and more efficient. Each project is taking fewer animals and fewer effort and fewer investment and burden on animals while doing so. But the other thing that's happening at the same time is we are exploding a demand for new models, more interesting, more specific, more able to do really, really interesting and exciting science, positive science. So that element of reducing is actually not necessarily what is happening with the use of genome editing. It is actually the opposite. We are seeing a rise in the number of use of animals. The next thing that one should always consider when we work with animals is refinement. We think of genome editing as a refinement on our use of animals and on our ability to make mutants. And of course, you know, this was really something that was a great hope when we first started with work with that technology, that is 2013. And here, the promise was extremely high. It was, I am going to make a mutant in the embryo, and what is going to be born is an animal that which I can predict, and it's going to be the only animal to do that I need to make my science. It is going to be the one that I want to study. Of course, this is not something that we have seen realizing as a promise, because when we actually look at how the system functions, if we want to do something very simple, like introducing a point mutation here, what we realize very, very quickly is that the system makes unpredictable mistakes and unpredictable repairs. So this is, you know, I'm not asking you to really get to the nitty-gritty of this slide, but what I would like you to see is that the products, the alleles which are produced from the use of CRISPR are, of course, what we are aiming for, but also are often accompanied with by other changes which are nearby, which are on target, which we never bargained for in the process. The other thing, and Gaëtan has pressure on this already, is that when we are thinking that we are going to create one animal which we are going to change in particular fashion, what we are doing is create a mosaic, an animal which has a complex genetic makeup in it. And the reason why we see that happening is that although we are delivering CRISPR at one cell embryo, so the idea is that it will be uniformly changed, what does happen, and so that's what we hope here, what does happen meanwhile is that the embryo carries on what an embryo does, which is developing. So what you are seeing here is a creation of independent compartments within the same individual, and this is within these different compartments that indeed the genome editing process is going to happen. So what you end up with is an animal, a complex animal, which is a mosaic, which has a genetic makeup, which is equivalent to have lots of different mutants contained within one single individual. And of course, that is a complexity that is not necessarily an easy one to reproduce. This has a direct consequence in terms of the sort of animal that we are producing. And here, this is the only video that I'm going to present today. Oh. Let's stop that, it's not pleasant. But what's happening here is that you will have seen a mouse which has a head which is tilted. It really has already at the founder level display the defect which we are expecting is going to be associated with this gene. So in the process of creating an animal which is simply a vehicle for generating the mutation, without being in a situation where we can really study this animal because this is a complex genetic being, we already start to see animal welfare issue in this animal which is just there for genome engineering. And this is something we see time and again, and it is an additional burden as opposed to refinement towards the animal use. So, the third R is the one that is possibly the one that we should all aim for the most, which is replacement. And indeed, the idea is that we should push our models and push our science in such a way that we are removing animals which are highly sentient and always try to go from a system which is less and less sensitive to its environment. And in effect, with genome editing, what we are seeing is actually turning this curve into the other direction. We are now able to modify in a very specific and directed fashion more and more sentient animals. And of course, these animal models are of extraordinary value in terms of science,
but they are actually a replacement which goes against the sort of natural tendency that you would hope the free art are pushing us towards. And then I would like to introduce a fourth R, which is reproducibility. There cannot be, of course, any justification of using animals in research if we are producing a research which is not reproducible. At the same time, what we are really realizing is genome editing is just a tool to cut DNA. It does not give you any control over the type of over the real sequence that you are going to produce from the act of using genome editing. And this is something that we really can see at play at very large scale. Here is an example where we are trying to do something very simple. Just a deletion. Cut here, it should resect here. We are all good, isn't it? It's simple. The reality is when we are trying to do that and when we look at the animal that we are producing, of course we see what we want to see, but we see all sorts of other types of events happening. Sometimes a very small change, very discrete, sometimes it is an insertion, sometimes it is duplication, sometimes it is actually bringing in a piece of DNA of which we have no idea where it comes from. This is really a complex sort of type of event that we are creating. So this is really difficult to have a strong handle on the outcome of this experiment. And that means that there is an enormous burden on validation of the model that we are producing. And of course, we are doing that. We are seeing this validation happening. We can sequence the bits of DNA that we want to put in, and they can appear all present and correct, and it's very, very good. But unless you sequence every single of the basis of this interval very, very carefully, you will miss small changes, very discrete. Here we have just three bases over this large interval, which happens to be not what we expected. So the burden of validation of this animal is essential if you want to ensure reproducibility, but it is something that is not entirely necessarily very well grasped by the field. The last thing that happens is even if you have satisfied yourself that you really have sequenced very carefully the interval you are working with, and this is something we've done here, there is other thing that can happen a little bit outside of the sphere where you are actually focusing. And it is somewhere else in the genome. If you are giving it a piece of DNA as a template for repair, this is the model that I would like to see integrated on my genome, you will also see in other places in the genome integration of the DNA that you have provided to the cell. So what this tells us here is that we find ourselves in this situation where we are producing a lot of mutants, and only a very small number of them are going to be the one that we can actually take forward and study because they actually correspond to all the quality criteria that we hoped they would have. And that takes us to possibly one of the main thing that we need to develop in the field, which is a set of standards for validation of the allele that we are choosing to use in laboratory research. And the few things I think that come to my mind are that the first generation that we are producing, we need to think of it as a container for mutations, but we really find it very difficult to ascertain the exact genetic makeup of this animal. The next thing that comes with this is that the next generation is the one where you can fully validate what you have done. And that's when you find out whether you can work with these animals. And that takes two things. That will take sequencing, and that will take counting the number of copies of the integration that you have put in the genome. And all these changes somehow are taking us in a situation where we are at the crossroad, and we are in the process of having important conversation, as this is happening here today. And to me, there are two alleys of conversation that needs to happen together at the same time: societal conversation and professional conversation. The societal one are key, of course. You know, we need to find a legal framework in which we can work, and we also need to have a legitimization of what we are doing to other societies. Otherwise, we are working we are going towards a situation where we cannot carry on functioning. And that involves having the right ethical justification, but that also requires, and that requires an awful lot of engagement in terms of the scientists. But what we need to keep in mind is all the literature on ethics of animal experimentation, all the things that have bothered us to before still do happen, and they are part of our conversation. But we also need to acknowledge that there are new aspects that we clearly are faced in by and which we hadn't bargained for. And for me, the one which is possibly the most challenging is the fact that we now have a very direct link between particular patients and animals that we are creating for them. Another part of this conversation is within the sphere of experts. And I think we need to all realize that we actually none of us is really expert of this technology. We are still all learning about it. It's too new for us to actually know what we are doing. And with that, we need to agree on standards as a professional body as to what are the good practices of genome editing. And I really do not think that we have a uniformity in the field in that respect. And finally, the thing that we should never forget about when we are working with animals is that we have a duty to always strive towards improving the way we are using animals and caring for the animals, and that is going to be applying to genome editing in the same way that we are applying that's applied to any laboratory animal research. So, if I want to leave you with one thing to stick in your mind, I would say CRISPR is a magic wand that makes spelling mistakes. And that is really something that is important to keep in mind. That means also that we are not necessarily ready to apply them straight away into human beings without worrying too much about the potential mistake that can happen. And with new technology, we have new questions which are ethical as well as practical. And we are facing very important debates in our society for the ethical aspect, and also very practical one among the experts that want to apply CRISPR editing. But at the end of the day, and I'm sorry, but a bit of my stat has gone here. Sorry. And at the end of the day, it's all a matter of solving that particular equation, balancing costs with benefits. And I don't think we can actually decide CRISPR is good or CRISPR is bad. The question that we have to ask every time is, for that particular experiment, is the cost that I am going for worthy of the benefit that is going to be gained and reaped from this experiment? And that is absolutely true for laboratory research. This is the sort of balance that we do every time that we make a new project. And that's potentially just as true when we are going to look at applying CRISPR in medicine. I have lots of people I really would want to take, but I'm just going to make a very short list, in particular Andy Greenfield, which is my partner in crime when we speak about, when we think about those things in Harwell, and of course funding body who allow us to do the work and find out about the technology. And thank you for your attention.